All right, so for the purposes of the recording, today's lesson is on practical editing or editing for portraits. Basically, the most common thing people probably do. And there goes my dog barking. That's great. Okay, so the most common editing that a lot of people probably do when they're taking pictures of each other. So if you're really into landscape photography or something like that, you're probably not going to use this skill as much, but it's still something that's good to know. We're just doing very simple editing today. Nothing too complicated or difficult. Just kind of learning how to pop color, fix skin, that kind of stuff. So I am going to share my screen. And you can probably hear Mr. Kivett and his dog in the background for the recording today, which is awesome. Keeping it real. Okay. So first of all, we open Pixlr as always, and we are going to dive into editing a portrait. I'm editing something that I took of this young lady. Her name is Avery. She is, gosh, I think she's a junior in high school, and I did some family pictures for her family, and so I pulled one of her pictures out of the camera. I haven't done any pre-editing to this at all. This is straight out of the camera. So the first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to play with, I'm going to do some adjustments, just because when I open it, I can see that it's kind of overexposed. She was wearing a white shirt, so whenever that happens, we tend to have more issues. So you're going to want to go up here to the adjustments and just pop into brightness and contrast. And then you're gonna get a little slide bar that pops up. I'm gonna pull the brightness down just a hair, and I'm gonna pull the contrast up a hair. And you notice when you pull the contrast up and down, it basically pulls out the blacks of the pictures or makes the picture richer. And I always encourage people to do that when they're working in portrait photography. A richer, more like depth-filled picture is always more interesting to look at. So I'm going to apply those. I might play with that a little bit more down the road, but that's where I'm going to start at, just so I'm not working with a totally overexposed image. I'm going to apply those. And then I'm going to zoom in on Avery's face. She's a beautiful girl, but as a lot of teenagers struggle with, she's got some skin issues. And really, not just teenagers, obviously, anybody. I still... real moment, like I still get acne and I'm 45. So, okay, so I'm gonna go over here and I'm gonna use the Band-Aid, which is the healing tool. Now, I can't do everything with the Band-Aid because what happens is it starts to create like a fake look on the image if you're not careful. And so I wanna make sure that I don't create a fake look. So I'm just gonna start, but over here where it's darker, I'm actually going to use a different tool to fix her skin over there, and I'm going to show that to you in a minute. So I'm just going to kind of go around and start adjusting little bits here and there that are in the lighter spot. Now, as you can see, even like to me, that last one looks kind of funny. So I'm going to take that one off and I'm going to use my clone stamp tool. Okay, so you're going to find all of those tools that we're using for this project over on this in this part of the toolbar. That was the healing tool, and now I'm gonna use the clone stamp tool. So I'm gonna click on that, and I'm gonna zoom in just a little bit more so I can make sure I'm really seeing what I'm doing. And I'm gonna go up and I'm gonna pick, actually the brush size is good at 50, but I'm gonna bring the opacity down. So whenever you're using the clone stamp on skin, you don't want to have the opacity up at 100%. Because that looks really weird. You'll see, like if I were to, I hit shift and that's what select. So I wanna select this lighter skin and kind of work on this acne right here. If I leave it at 100, it looks really, really weird. See how it created like just a big dot right there? And that's because I left it at 100%. So I don't wanna do that. So I'm gonna go up and I'm gonna change the opacity to like 40% and see, and you just kind of have to play with this until you get it where you like it. Now, like I said, I'm going to pull some of this lighter skin in to kind of work on this acne. So I hit shift and I press the left click on my mouse, and that's how I start selecting wherever the cursor is when you hit shift and click left click. That's, you're selecting that part of the picture, you're grabbing that part of the picture, And you're basically then painting that part of the picture over here. Now I would keep messing with this. Like, I'm not 100% happy with, it looks a little bumpy to me, but for the sake of time and like not boring you to death, I'm just gonna kind of do a rough job here. So I'm just doing the same thing over and over again, just kind of working on her skin, just right here, where we have a little bit of skin issues. And again, this is not perfect. Like, I want you guys to be a little bit more careful than I'm being for the sake of example, but it's definitely better than it was. Okay, now I'm gonna zoom out and see if there's anything weird there that I wanna fix. It looks pretty good. All right, now I'm gonna do the same thing under her eyes. So naturally in digital photography, we get, there's a couple things that happen automatically in digital photography. The bags under our eyes, which like I said earlier, 45, they happen. And you can't, like, when you take a digital image, it just, like, for whatever reason, really enhances any kind of baggage we have under our eyes. So she's pretty young, so hers is minimal, but you would probably find with older people that you're gonna get more bags or more darkness underneath the eye. And if you just help remove that a little bit, it makes everything look a little cleaner and, like, not, you're not tired, okay? So I'm gonna pull her nice bright cheek skin right here, and I'm just gonna come in under her eye a little and just remove, there's not very much. Like I said, she's young and it was a well-lit day, so that definitely helps. If you're in a lot of shadows, you're probably gonna end up with some more of that under the eye. I'm just brightening under her eye a hair. The other thing, her mouth is closed, so you can't tell, but the other thing that always happens with digital photography, maybe not phones, but like nice cameras, for whatever reason, if people have any kind of yellow hue to their teeth at all, even if you can't hardly see it with the naked eye, the digital camera completely enhances the yellow of teeth. So I actually don't know in this program how I would fix that. And when I'm in Photoshop, I have preset stuff into my Photoshop, and it's a like tool that's called porcelain veneers, and I can adjust teeth so they look white and not yellow. So those are some of the things you kind of have to think about. Okay, and then from here, there's some other things we can do. All right, so I fixed her skin, I've brightened under her eyes. You can leave it like that and she'd probably be happy with it. But there's a couple other things that I would encourage you to do when you're working on portrait photography. So sometimes the eyes don't come through as crisp as we'd like them to. And so there is a way to add a little sparkle back to her eye. And I'm gonna go over here and use this tool, which is the little like teardrop or raindrop. It's the Blur Sharpen Smudge tool. I'm gonna click on that. And I'm gonna use the Sharpen. And over here, just like with every tool, we have a strengthness and brush size that we can adjust. I'm gonna leave it right where it is. So it's at brush 50 right now, which is roughly the size of her eyeball. And strength 66 is probably good. If you go up to 100, it's just gonna be like with the clone stamp, it's gonna overdo it and start to look really, really fake. 66 actually might be too strong, but I'm gonna leave it right there. And you just left click and kind of color over that eye and see how it just makes it like her eye look a little bit more crisp. And I'm gonna do it there too. And that's all. I'm not gonna do a lot more than that. She has beautiful eyes, so I do wanna bring them out if I can. And adding that little bit of twinkle back in there is a great way to do that. Okay, now it feels like I'd like to enhance the color a little bit. For instance, I know that her color in her hair isn't as kind of dull as it looks in this image, which happens a lot with digital photography. Things get dulled out a little bit. So I'm gonna go up here to, I have to find it. It's different in here than in, where is it? I'll get there. Is it here? Yes, okay, sorry about that. So it's the little sun, it says sponge color. That's the tool I'm gonna use here. And there's actually two ways to do what I'm doing right now, but I'm gonna show you this way first. So this is using a tool where you're like gonna spot change things in the picture, like basically you're painting onto the picture. And I'm going to use the saturation tool because I want to bring the color. I want to saturate the color a little bit more and really bring that out. I'm going to leave my brush the size it is because it's perfect for kind of painting over her hair. Right now, the strength is at 30. I think that's a good place to start. If you go too high with this, it looks, everything starts to look orange or like overly bright, and we want it to still look natural. So I'm just going to come in over her hair and see how that just starts to like pull the color of her hair out a little bit more, and it gives it a lot more vibrancy to the image just by pulling the color of her hair out. And again, if I had this up much more than 30% on here, it would look pretty bad, I think. And then I'm going to come in and I'm just going to, I am going to change my brush size right now so that I can just bring out her eyes a little bit. So I'm going to color over her eyes in the saturation tool, and that's just going to bring that blue out. That is so pretty. That's so pretty. Okay, and then I'm going to pull out, and then maybe I want to pull out her jean color a little bit because it's one of the few things in the picture that actually has color. I should have made my brush a little bigger, but you get the idea. So I'm pulling out the jeans just because we actually have some color there. And then I'm gonna take the strength down a little bit more. It's barely there, and I'm gonna make my brush a little bit bigger, and I'm gonna go over her face. And this is just gonna add a little bit of color back to her skin. Okay, so now what I've done is I've adjusted my contrast and my brightness. I have fixed her skin, I've brightened under her eyes, I've added some color back to her hair, her eyes. I have added some twinkle back to her eyeballs specifically to make them sharper in focus. And last, what I think I wanna do is maybe play with the blacks a little bit more. So I'm gonna go up to the adjustment. And by blacks, I mean like the darker elements of the picture to keep working with that depth. And I'm gonna go back to my brightness and my contrast right there. And I'm just gonna pull up on the contrast a little bit more. I like that better. Now that I've worked with her hair, her eyes, her skin, and all of those things, I like pulling up that black just a little bit more. Now, another way that you can play with all of the same adjustments that I just made to this picture, you can go up here and you'll notice that you can play with the temperature, the hue, the saturation. That's all of the coloring stuff that I was doing, but it enhances the picture as a whole. So that works great if you're working with landscape photography and you're wanting all the greens and everything to just boom, pop on the whole picture. But if you're working with something like a person, and you don't want their skin to become overly orange compared to their hair that you want more color in, then you want to use these isolating tools over here so that you're only adjusting one part of the image at a time. And that is how you do some basic editing for portraitures or senior pictures or pictures of your friends. Do you guys have any questions about what you just watched me do?
How do you get rid of shadows?
Say that again.
How do you get rid of shadows in a picture?
Like get rid of shadows, like can you give me an example?
Like if you take a picture of somebody and like your shadow's in it and you don't want it in it.
Got it. Okay, so first of all, that can be kind of difficult to get rid of without making them look really weird, especially if your shadow's going over like their face. But let me just show you really quick. So let's say your shadow was like just maybe over this part of her arm. So if it's over her face, it's gonna be really, really difficult to work with because you're gonna be using the clone stamp tool to fix that. And that is really hard to fix on skin like what I'm gonna show you. So if I'm using the clone stamp tool and I have it at 100%, and I'm gonna make my brush just a little bit bigger. Okay, so if I'm using this at 100% and I select, let's say your shadow's right here, you don't have a shadow here, but you do have it here, that brush is gonna be too big. Okay, so let's say the shadow's here that you're trying to get rid of, basically you have to clone stamp where there is no shadow and recreate the next part So, like I said, with a face, that's really difficult because you're potentially clone stamping. You know, let's say your shadow's over her face right here. You're trying to clone stamp skin, and it's going to start to look really weird. So if your shadow is in it over the face, there's just not a lot that you can do. You can lighten it, and you can try to isolate it with like the wand tool and lighten it that way. Sometimes I have two subjects, one is in the shadows and one is not. I will just select by using the like one of these tools. I might just select their face, and then I might just brighten or darken what I've selected specifically. But yeah, getting rid of shadows is really tricky. It takes a lot of like focused energy. If I had a sample picture, Tony, I probably could answer that easier for you. So if you have one you want to send me, I can work on it and let you know how I adjusted it.
Okay.
Yeah. Any other questions? So yeah, anytime you're trying to eliminate something from a picture, clone stamp is the way to go, but you have to have something in the image that you want to like copy and paste into the new area. Okay, so really quickly, I'm gonna go over just a couple posing tips because you are all gonna take a portrait of somebody for this assignment. So this assignment's gonna be that you take a portrait of somebody, that you put that into Pixlr and that you do some basic edits to it that I just showed you. And then when you turn in your image, I want to make sure this is super clear. When you turn in your image, you turn in the original and the edited, and then you tell me the steps that you took to edit that picture. So you're going to tell me what you adjusted. I adjusted contrast and shadows. I adjusted I added some sharpness to the eyes. I saturated there. Shirt, any adjustments you make to the picture, you're going to write out and include that with your finished product. So it's a before, an after, and then an actual verbal explanation of what you did. So I'm going to put up, when I put up the assignment at the end of the day today, I am going to include a couple of YouTube videos just on how to pose people. Some of you are going to get way into it, and some of you are going to be like, hey, yo, Hannah, go stand against the wall and take your picture. Like that. Either of those are okay, because the project is about the editing, not necessarily about the picture. But if you want to be good at posing people and working with people, there's some great tools out there that you can utilize between now and when you turn this image in to take good pictures. But simple things like, for instance, this picture right here, simple things in how you have their body. Notice with her arm flat up against her body, it makes her arm wider and it doesn't give her as good of a shape. So just having her bring her arm up onto her hip and turn out just a little bit from the camera, changing her angle just a little, it all of a sudden it slims her and it gives her more visual interest, and it brings more of her face into the focus, which is good. There's lots of different like tips. Excuse me. There's lots of different tips out there that you can get. Let me see if I can pull out any of the other that like are kind of good versus bad. There was this really interesting hand one. When you have people putting their hands up, a lot of people put their hands like kind of up on their face, you know, noticing like a flat hand on a face versus a rounded hand on a face can make a really big difference. Trying to see if there's any specific to that on here. Well, there, I don't see a lot of specific on here about that, but on the videos that I will share with you guys that you can watch, it's going to kind of walk you through the differences between having somebody turn into the light, away from the light, if you put them up against a wall, giving the image some depth. And then of course you guys really want to, with this, it will be so much easier to do the editing if you pay attention to your lighting. If you have somebody standing in the bright sun or in a funny sun patch or under a lamp inside, any of that lighting is going to be way harder for you to work with. I encourage you to take your model outside. Even if it's raining, just find a spot underneath some cover and get that natural light. because the picture will be a lot easier to edit. And then make sure that you do have them pose a little so that you have something to work with, okay? Do you guys have any questions? Okay, it seems like you guys know what you're doing, so I'm gonna stop the recording right now.